Revelation chapter 20, if you would get that for me. And I'm going to begin at the 11th verse once I get there. Revelation 20, verse 11. How are you doing? If you're happy and you know it, clap your hands. All right. It's so good to be with you today, and it's good to be alive. It is. I take nothing for granted. Not one heartbeat, because, you know, it could skip a beat. I don't take for granted my lungs, because some people that love Jesus are short of breath today. And now I'm fully breathing. Yeah, I'm taking it all in. And so for this reason, I am thankful along with you. You know, Thanksgiving is a key to overthrowing the harassment of the enemy. Because he comes to harass you. And of course, we know that he lies all the time. But nonetheless, his lies can be harassing because they have a sprinkle of truth in it. Just a sprinkle of things that are factual just to get across the lie that he's perpetrating. And his motive is always to murder. And his method is always the lie. Say that with me. His motive? To murder. His method? The lie. That means murder a life, murder your dreams, murder your hopes, bring an end to the purpose of God in your life. But the scripture says that everybody who puts their trust in him, he will not fail them. He went as far as to say, I will come to you personally. And we say, even so, come, Lord Jesus. Amen. And so I wanted to really, as we were in worship, the Lord kind of included this scripture, and I'm going to give you the end of the matter and work it backwards. Is that okay? All right. 11th verse, Revelation chapter 20, and this is a very solemn scripture because it tells you just kind of how things are going to be, and they're yet in our future, but yet we're not ones who would say, oh, Lord, Pastor, only tell us the good things and not prepare us for the things that will happen to those who don't love Jesus, that maybe it will energize our faith to speak more and speak more often when given the opportunity and led by the Spirit of the Lord. So this is the great white throne judgment. It is a throne of judgment. It is the judgment throne of the wicked dead. You're going to find in this scripture where people are being brought out of hell to stand before God. Isn't that something? People coming out of hell thinking they're going to get a break. Well, and we're going to find out that that's going to end after the judgment. They get to go to the lake of fire. Now, I don't say that happy, but I'm not mad either. Because the Lord is altogether righteous. And that his judgments are faithful and true. That he has never at any time been ungodly, unrighteous, and he's never been wrong. And if you've got a bunch of rattlesnakes living in your closet, don't tell me you wouldn't call a brother and say, I got some rattlesnakes in my closet. And then they tell you, oh, just love them. But no, that closet is near my grandbaby's room. Oh, love them more effectively. No, you're going to go in and you're going to get somebody that's going to come in there and say, we got you covered. You stay over in this room. And if you don't want to see this, don't come back here. But we're going to take them out. Now, I know some of you like say, oh, I don't want to hurt nothing. Well, they're in the wrong closet. They're near the baby's closet. Now, from that perspective, by the baby's closet, we're just not going to let that go down. Likewise, some of you fathers that have little babies, if someone would ever threaten your little baby, it would be probably not a good day for them. I mean, it's not like you don't love God, but they shouldn't just come in your house and cross your threshold, and then offer threats towards your wife and baby. It'd probably be a day that they need Alka-Seltzer or something for the stomach. It just wouldn't be a good day for them. And I know you being godly would say, oh, just go about your business. Why should I go about my business? Oh, because I may hurt you in the name of the Lord. While you're smiling. Yeah, that should be a clue right there because, you know, back in the day, and this is back when. All right, roll with me here because some of you know what I mean by back in the day. But back in the day, they used to have little skirmishes and fights in grade school. And whenever there's a fight, everybody would cry out, fight, 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 fight. But there are some people that before they fight you, they would start crying. And that's not the person you want to really do battle with. Now, that one is acting like he's Bruce Lee and, ooh, and all of that. He's not Bruce. But the fellow who starts crying, we always knew he was the winner before the fight started. Because all of those passions of everything he felt hurt about, all of those feelings of who he think betrayed him are welling up and he's about to wail them on you. So we're not those who fight like that anymore. Am I right? I'm just saying. Then I saw a great white throne in him. And the point I was trying to make is that this is the Lord's earth. This is his earth. And he's given us the privilege to live on it. This is his land. This is his nation, as the nations of the world all belong to him. And so therefore, if he's going to remove the rattlesnakes, you get the point now? Then I saw a great white throne and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was no place found for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. Notice the plural, books. And another book, singular, was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books, plural. And the sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and hell, or Hades, delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged, and each one according to his works. Then death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Continue. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. Listen, I'm not happy about this. I'm not sad about this. It's just that's the way it is. I didn't write it. But it also reminds me of just the way things are going to be and that there's victory for those who believe in him, that there's overcoming victory for those who trust him. But yet we cannot just be hyped up on all on the good without reflecting on, hey, these things are going down. And it's not like it might begin sometime. It's already in play. The works and the deeds of people are already in play. So now we see that God, and you better be glad, is getting the rattlesnakes out of his planet. Because he is going to be Lord of Lords, King of Kings, and the last enemy to be destroyed will be death. And he'll wipe away all the tears from our eyes. It's a promise of God. And I'm just telling you, there's a difference between saved and unsaved. It is. Sometimes people like to merge the two together, but there is a difference between saved and unsaved. It really is. It's a difference between going to heaven and not going to heaven. There's a difference between righteousness and ungodliness. There is a difference between the church at Ephesus and the church at Philadelphia and the church at Laodicea. There's a difference. Laodicea was lukewarm, not hot, not cold, don't want to stand for nothing. And the church at Philadelphia had the secret sauce. May we ever endeavor to have the secret sauce. And you would say, I know you want to ask this question, Pastor, what is the secret sauce?
What is the secret sauce?
Together? We're not together. We're not together. We're not together. Are you ready? Together, your question is?
Pastor, what is the secret sauce?
I am so glad that you were moved by God to ask me that question. What is the secret sauce and what makes a glorious church? What makes a glorious church? Well, let me tell you what doesn't make a glorious church, even though funding is very important and it's honorable to honor God. With the first fruit of your increase, it is an honor to do so. It's a privilege to do so. And it's God's economic system for providing for us that we can glorify Him. Now, but that's not really the secret sauce. The secret sauce is not just a humongous number of people. It really isn't the secret sauce to glorious church. Glorious church is this, is that when the church, no matter where they assemble, calling on the name of the Lord, love each other. That's the glorious church. Now, see, if we use that measure, it won't mean how strong they are from a financial standpoint. It doesn't mean their numerics. It isn't measured by that. But the true measurement of God working in your life is that you love one another. And this is the commandment that Jesus made. He said, I give you a new commandment that has never been said before. And this commandment is that you love one another the way I have loved you. Notice he didn't say that you love your neighbor like you love yourself. Because if you view through the lens of self, it simply means if I own a jacket, I'll buy you a jacket. And the way I would treat self is the way I would treat you. However, Jesus was speaking to his people when he said, I want you to love one another the way I have loved you. And that is going to stand. Because we see what the lack of love will do. This is not a political statement by any means. It's a human statement. Why does somebody think that it was appropriate to take the life out of their own decision, I'm going to kill the president? It's upon me. I'm going to shoot him. This has got nothing to do with a political stance. It has everything to do with humanity. That in the last days, they will betray one another. They will hate one another. They will kill one another. And so why is the Lord telling us these things so that we can be prepared to remain a sanctified, holy people unto the Lord while he navigates us through this wicked world? And you should say, amen. And so there can be a tendency of blindness that is not happening here, that is not happening. But let me tell you something. If you leave a sponge in water long enough, it'll soak up the water and get in the whole entire sponge. Am I right? And so therefore, the truth of the matter is, I was just amazed that, and I was reflecting over time, how many people have chosen to take somebody else's life for no cause. Just because I don't like you, or because I hate you, or just anything like that. It is Adam's nature being perpetuated by Satan's intent. The demonic powers in the earth can only be overthrown in our lives personally and through our lives through our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so, but let it be known that we are not fighting against flesh and blood, that we fight against principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in heavenly places. Listen, and the only solution to the world issue is our faith. That's why Jesus said, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man loves the world and its systems and its indulgences, then the love of the Father is not perfected or is not in you. And so he gives, writing to the church, a solemn, strong, fatherly warning. Say, listen now, you make some adjustments because the scriptures are going to be fulfilled and God is not angry with his people. He settled that anger through Jesus, but it doesn't mean that I'm going to mistreat him. And I know you wouldn't have a heart to mistreat him. But the world is what it is. It is a totally different system based on different values, having a different constitution. Jesus said, love your neighbor. Somebody else said, let's kill our neighbor. Jesus said, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. And the world said, who is the goat? Who is the greatest of all time? Calvary testified that Jesus is the greatest of all time. And so therefore, we got this dual kingdom in operation. We've got a world that's governed by the enemy and the prince of the power of the air, Satan himself. And then we have the kingdom of God working in the hearts of men, fulfilling the plan of God, receiving the best of God and the blessing of God, and even through trial and tribulation to know him even better in that. Because we're not frivolous to say, well, that means everything's going to be perfect in my life. And it's not perfect. Something's wrong with God. No, God has done his part and is continuing to do and fulfill his word. But he did say, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers them from them. How many? All. That's right. Because we are kingdom in conflict. Sheep and goats, good fish, bad fish, tares and wheat, simultaneously operating together. Now, with that being said, and thinking about the great white throne judgment, and that day is yet in the future, it is what it is, but we're not going to just float around and think, wait a minute, God's going to get his earth back together, and the kingdom was going to be delivered back to the Father, and what God's own, what he owns is going to be full of righteousness. The beautiful thing about God, God gives a person a choice. The day you hear my voice, don't harden your heart. How about that? And the voice of God is not necessarily the voice of man, but the man who's speaking the voice of God through the word of God is worthy to take heed of. You see, there are so many demonic factors that are opposing you, that undercover schemes to overthrow your faith and harass your thought, that God says, I tell you what, come to me. And if you will stay with me, I will fight your battle. If you trust me, you will see with your eyes the reward of the wicked. And so therefore, it is good not just to say, well, I'm a Christian. Well, you not know that is so powerful to say that I'm a Christian as to what it means if we change the kind of the demographics and a little bit about the atmosphere and all of a sudden they're killing Christians. It's been done before. And to say I'm a Christian during those periods, that meant something. It meant commitment. You know, when he's writing in the book of Romans, he said, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Well, during the Roman period in which he was writing this, Caesar believed that he was Lord, that he was equal to one of the gods, the Roman gods. And so therefore, he was like Jupiter in the flesh, a Minerva in the flesh, which were the Roman idols. And so they kind of built him up like you are a god and not a man. Okay, he's dead. Think about that one, Caesar. So the point that we're making, that when they confess with their mouth, if they would make a statement about their faith, it could cost them. Even when I was in Israel, some of the believers there would whisper to me and say, are you Christian? It meant something. I said, I am. And she said to me, I worship Yeshua too. I believe in Yeshua. Why was she whispering? because it wasn't a popular thing in the region in which I was standing. Because, you know, you got these groups and you got Judaism, and Judaism and believing in Jesus doesn't mix. They may not be outward about it for geopolitical reasons, but just, you know, how religion is. Well, my point is, it means something to be a believer. And there's a difference. Jesus will come to you because you are his. He promised he would. And there is no weapon formed against you that would ever prosper because you are his. And because the Lord is on my side, think about that. The Lord is on my side. He's on your side. He is more for you than the world could ever be against you. So now let's go on this journey, and I'm just really warming up here. And I want to start with Luke chapter 17, if you would. I want to call this business as usual. You say it, business as usual. All right, Luke 17, 22 through 30. Then he said to the disciples, "The days will come when you will desire to see one of the days of the Son of Man," speaking of himself, "and you will not see it. And they will say to you, 'Look here,' or 'Look there.' Do not go after them or follow them. For as the lightning that flashes out of one part under the heaven shines to the other part under heaven, so also the Son of Man will be in his day. But first he must suffer many things," speaking of the crucifixion, "and be rejected by this generation. And as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be also in the days of the Son of Man." Here's the state that he's talking about. They ate, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark. And the flood came and destroyed them all. Pause just for a moment. It was just business as usual for them. And for 100 years, this man was a preacher of righteousness while he was building the ark, and only 8 souls agreed with him. Next verse. "Likewise," including, "as it was also in the day of Lot, they ate, they drank, they bought, they sold, they planted, they built. But on the day that Lot went out of Sodom, it rained fire and brimstone from heaven and destroyed them all. Even so will it be in the day when the Son of Man is revealed." Now, this is telling you, you've got one side business as usual and another side expecting, the other side believing, and you have the story of Noah, who built the ark. And some people say, "I just can't believe that scientifically." I suggest you believe it by faith. Amen? Believe it because God said it. "Even so will it be when the Son of Man revealed." He's speaking about Lot. Lot was in a bad situation in the atmosphere, and the people in his community were not nice people. They were morally corrupt people, and they had changed the use of man and use of woman and flipped it and all of that. And Lot was down there being vexed, they said. He was vexed by their behavior. And there came a time when God brought them out, and yet he judged that city. Now, I know that there are people who would say, "I don't want to serve a God that will destroy people." And do you want to serve a God that will give you air to breathe? So, man, let's just go with the whole loaf. Remove the snakes from the closet is what we're talking about. Because he has a better plan. It was never his plan for evil to, even though he knows all things, he didn't plan for evil to continue and to advance. He didn't plan it, even though he was aware of all things. What God has in plan is a place and an earth of righteousness, of godliness, of loving one another. Let me visit on that just for a little bit before I go to the next point. The secret sauce is loving one another. And to love one another is probably to try to get to know one another. It'll be a good idea. Amen. Because you never know how wonderful your love would be towards somebody. And if you don't say, well, I don't know who, and this, just ask the Spirit of God, he'll see, it's nice to be nice. It's kind to be kind. And it's good to be able to have a hospital for the hurting. And to have a celebration place for those who are in victory. And anybody in between, there's a place for you. You see, the woman who came to Jesus, and Jesus said, it's not right to give the children bread to the pets and the dogs, and because she wanted her baby healed. And she said, yeah, Lord, but the dogs get the crumbs that fall from the master's table. And Jesus said, for that saying, your child is made whole. And the point of it is that he gave her not just the leftovers that people throw away. He gave her a seat at the table for the kingdom of God. And see, God has prepared a table for you right in the presence of your enemies. And you'll be able to testify, even in spite of that, your cup's running over, and surely goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life. And so now we have this situation about loving one another. And loving one another can be challenging. Let me tell you why. Not because a person is a bad person. It's just challenging for you to step out of your zone to say hi to a person at Kroger's. Let the church be the church. And so therefore, no matter how evil and dark people are getting and the reports of it, it never should disrupt the love of God flowing through you. That there should be a confidence just to be kind. That the heavy anointing is when you're nice. Jesus went about doing good. How God anointed Jesus with the Holy Ghost and with power, and he went about doing good. Because, see, the love of God overthrows many evils. It does. And so, therefore, in our assembly here local, let us strive, for the secret sauce to kind of, like, really love one another, and with an expectation we are going to be together forever. How about that? You said, Pastor, I don't know if I want to be around you forever. Get over it. I'm coming to your house and eating. Yes, I am. So just get over it. And if anybody say, well, you know, there's Pastor coming again, then prepare a table before me right in the presence of the godly. Yeah, there's always a way to break through. And you should practice now. But it is a good thing to love one another. It is a good thing to have each other's back. It's a wonderful thing never to manipulate or to seek to manipulate, because what that does is put a breach in the flow of God's plan of the love of God. To care for you the way I care for me, that I should love you the way Jesus loved me. Now, if I put love you the way I love myself and I put it on the scale, okay, we can work with that. But to love you the way Christ has loved me. Oh, how beautiful his love is for me. How wonderful his love is for me. And I'm not in a special category. The truth of the matter is, God is love. Think about that. I had to do a funeral down in Virginia last week. I told you about it Sunday prior to that, that I was going down, I was going to, you know, the friend that I had ministered to had passed away. You know, I talked to him in Walmart parking lot. It turned very serious when he said, man, I thank God for you. I said, man, that's good. He said, no, I thank God for you. I said, okay, brother, that's good. He said, no, you saved my life. And it'll be a matter of days. He was dead. So I get down there seeing Mama while she's pushing me around the whole week, You know, I need you to move that. I need you to do that. And so, all right. So much fun. So I get a call, and they said, could you do this? I said, yeah, I'll do it for him. So I did a teaching. I just taught on grace and faith. It really wasn't really a funeral as much as it was a teaching to the general audience. And so people came later and responded like, you know, they just hadn't heard that way before. The power of God's influence and the response by our faith towards God. And God knew what he was doing. I obeyed, and God got the victory. My point is saying that funerals are challenging for me. Can I confess that with you? And you're not, oh, you can, put it in the paper. They're challenging because I'm dealing with the heart of a broken person because of a loved one. And given the word of God and the weight of God's word and the weight of compassion that you would have for a person who's lost somebody they love, it is no easy work for me. So I'm very dependent on the Lord to do them. And some people like to do them. I'm not one that's wave a flag, choose me. But the opportunity for God to speak into the heart is where I'm going. When they can realize before them is someone who once lived, that they have fulfilled the scripture. It's appointed unto men once to die. And this is not turning dark. I'm just telling you this is a reality. But eternal life is in play. Eternal life means we never stop. Eternal life means we never die. We'll separate from this body, but we will never, ever die. We'll never stop. We won't even come to the funeral. Get that down in your heart of faith, that I'm never going to die. It's not coming my way. You said, Pastor, where'd you get that from? Well, it's in the Bible, believe it or not. Jesus said, if a man lives and he dies, he shall live again. And then he said, if a man believe in me, he shall never die. And so that's the faith that anchors us, so that no matter what noise on the outside, it doesn't overthrow the peace of God on the inside. All right. I want you to go with me to something. I want you to know the fact that we are in God, that we should never be high-minded, that we should never be arrogant, puffy, and proud. Let's look at why. Titus chapter 3, verse 1 through 8. Remind them to be subject to rulers and authorities, to obey, to be ready for every good work, to speak evil of... Let's see. The Amplified version says, stay off of YouTube. No, I didn't say that. No, because we are on YouTube, so don't do that. To speak evil of no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing all humility to all men. Now, this is our disposition. Why? For we ourselves were also once, come on, say it. We were once foolish, and I know somebody ready to fold their arms. I don't have nothing against your arm folding, but I'm just telling you, you were once also, it's good to testify, once foolish, and guess what? Disobedient and deceived, serving various lusts. I just like how clear the Bible is. Serving various lusts and pleasures, living in malice and envy, hateful and hating one another. But when? Everyone say, but when? But when the kindness and the love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared. Yeah. not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. Through the washing of regeneration and the renewing of the Holy Spirit, God Almighty, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. There's a difference between being saved and unsaved. And it's not business as usual for us. And so with this precious promise given to us, with this confidence in knowing who we belong to because of a decision of the heart, then this is available to us. And so therefore, we can be compassionate on people because we can always remember, even though it's been washed away and forgiven, that at some time in your life, let me just say in my life, I'm going to just speak for me. Can I speak for me? You say speak for yourself. Okay, and I'll come down your street next. I was at some time foolish, disobedient. I was disobedient to my daddy, but I was a few football fields away. He never heard me talk back to him. I was making sure. And then I would just tell him off. Because I wanted to play ball. He wanted me to cut the grass. So I had something to say. As long as I was a long distance away. That's my rap song right there. I had something to say as long as a distance away. Yeah. Yeah. But being justified by his grace, that means just as if I'd never done anything wrong. Glory to God. Just as if I have done nothing. Flawed humans justified by God. And who shall bring charge to God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who shall bring you before the court when the judges of judges have rendered you free? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is really hallelujah. This is hallelujah to all the scales come off of your eyes. Hallelujah till your heart begins to leap inside. Hallelujah until you say that the love of God has come to me. Hallelujah for the house of Jones and Baker and Ricks and the house of Roberts is going to rise up to give him glory in the morning with thanksgiving in our heart that we won't play him cheap, that we will love him on Sunday and on Monday we'll change our mind. We are those who are devoted. We are those who are dedicated. We're running this race to the finish line. We are not quitting. We're not giving up. We are not wimps. We're not sellout, and we're not full of lust. But we've been sanctified by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and he has made a difference. I am not what I used to be. And I don't do the things I used to do. Because he that is wonderful has forgiven me. And if God be for you, who can be against you? First John 5, it gives us the secret to overcoming the world and its systems. And then we're going to go to Hebrews 10 and wrap up. 1 John 5, 3, third verse. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not burdensome. They're not grievous. For whatever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. Who is he that who overcomes the world but he who believes that Jesus Christ is the Son of God? All right, let's go to Hebrews chapter 10 and follow me here, beginning at the 37th verse. This is quoted from Habakkuk. For yet a little while, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. So let's just get happy. Go back to that one. Let's just get happy about that. Jesus is coming. He hasn't started the journey because it won't take him that long to get here. But he is coming because he said he's coming. Now, for yet a little while, and he who is coming will and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith. But if anyone draws back, my soul has no pleasure in him. But we are not of those who draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul. The just shall live by faith. The just shall live by faith. In other words, not just saving faith, that I called on the name of the Lord and he answered me and he cleansed me and forgave me of all my sin. And now I'm not full of pride because he overthrew that. And I humble myself before him and he overthrew my troubles. And so we see here is that the just shall live by faith, which means you have to purchase your next vehicle by faith. What does that mean to purchase a vehicle by faith? I thought we purchased it with money. Listen, money is what it is. But by faith means the day after you buy it, the transmission doesn't fall out. Because by faith you say, Lord, I can't see in the scripture whether I should buy this vehicle or not. But if you would speak to my heart and tell me what to do, I look to you by faith in Jesus Christ that you would lead and guide me into truth. Didn't he say he'll do it? So all of a sudden you get a feeling on the inside of it, even though it's the car you like and even though it's got those little special blacked out rims and all of that. And the Holy Spirit said, not that one. And you say, oh, well, let me die. That's the devil. No, that was not the devil. Anytime you can't get what you don't want, but you want something, you feel like you can't get it, then it's the devil. But no, remember Sunday, where Jeff Hall, we preached about you last two Sundays ago. Jeff gonna roll up into my house and, oh, Pastor. It doesn't sound like Rocky, doesn't it? Rocky Balboa. Like he just came out the ring, you know. And, oh, Pastor, you know, I just want to say, share something with you. And, He said, you know, when God tells you yes, he's blessing you. When he tells you no, he's protecting you. And when he tells you wait, he's working it out. That's pretty good, isn't it? That's pretty good. He's working it out. And so what we want you to know is that living by faith also includes what you think to be the simple things. And I know I could have bought it, but I didn't feel it. I felt a check in my spirit that was not the wise choice. And it may have all the paint and everything, but if it's not right at this time, you'll be best led by the Spirit of the Lord, even though your I want this center of your soul is being overruled by your spirit saying, not now. And do you not know when you get a not now, you could go 2 days and go back? Like maybe God didn't really mean that, and I'm going to go look at it again. Well, he really meant it then, and he loved you enough to say, didn't I tell you? Or he'll say something like, I've got better for you than that. And then you say, but I can afford this. Listen to who you're talking to. Yeah, I did that once before, and you've heard that story, but just a nice little house out on Ludlow. It had two bedrooms, I believe, and a buck stove. That was a hot ticket right there because we were in an energy crisis, and man, buck stove was where it at. Where, you know, I was doing those days, I was Ebenezer Scrooge, you know. I wasn't squandering any money. And so I'm just beginning, so I was trying to save every penny I could, and the buck stove was the ticket. So I just knew that was the house, took Miss Sheila out there, looked at it and everything, and oh, happy day. So I decided to go to the Lord and just to let him know that's what he wants for me. And so I got into prayer, and I had to be serious about it. I said, then, Lord, I want your will to be done. Why did I say that? I meant it. I want your will to be done. Lord God, is this the house? And he said, son, this is not the house.
But see, because God was looking, we had one child. One child. Bethany. That would fit. But God saw five children down the road. And while he was telling me no, he was protecting me. And wait, he was working it out. Because in his mind, five children, little buck stove and little house, you're going to be doing this again. So the wisdom of God will come to you in the moment. Where God conveys to you what he knows. That's what wisdom is. When he conveys to you what he knows, give you insight to what he sees. Without you having to be in next month, he is sitting in next month, surveyed it already, and will tell you yes or no. Let us be led by the Spirit of the Lord. Amen? Amen. So the just shall live how? By faith. The just shall live by faith. And how do you live by faith without just saying, I live by faith? The song said that. The first song they sang. I said, that was on target. Well, live by faith is living by something that God has said. Now, one thing you don't have to ask God, Lord, should I love my wife? Now, that's already in the scripture. You don't have to get a divine revelation, and Michael doesn't have to come down from heaven to reveal to you, yes, you should, because it's already clearly defined in scripture. But sometimes things are not clearly defined, like buying this or investing in this. So that's why we employ the mind of God and live by faith. And so therefore, anything in the word is what we live by. So that's why we read the Bible, so we'll know what's in the policy. Not wait for calamity to try to read the fine print or have to call somebody else to find out, is this covered? Read this book, you'll find out what is covered. And you'll find out everything is covered. Because if God be for you, nothing can be against you. My point is this. Living by faith is changing your conduct to mirror the life of Jesus. My conduct. Living by faith. I do that not by effort first, but by faith. And the power behind faith is God himself. Faith is us believing God to the point that we obey him. But the power and the results of faith comes from God. Prove it. Okay, I will. If you have faith as a mustard seed and say to this mountain. Now, the point of it is, it's simply not talking of small faith. But powerful faith, because a small seed making a great bush is a result of big faith. Big faith is your capacity to believe a big God. That's it. That you wholeheartedly trust him. So, for example, let's say you had a conflict. All right. And you need to go over and tell your cousin a thing or two. And you really mean to tell them a thing or two. You are hot. Your wife is saying, baby, don't go, don't go. You said, I'm going over there. I need to talk with him. And then she says, but baby, what does the Bible say? The purpose for wives. To bring balance. Hey, what does the Bible say? And then all of a sudden, Bubba said, well, what does it say? It says, love your neighbor as you love yourself. He doesn't deserve to be loved, and neither do we. But God does. Do you know what God brought us from? Do you know where he pulled us out of? Do you know the stuff we were into? Do you know the lies we believed? But now he brought light to our heart. We love one another. I mean, you were over there working on Mr. Joe's car for him. And when he wanted to give you money, you refused it. That's God's love working in you. And you can let God's love prevail in this too. Then he looked at her Her name is Bertha. Bertha, that's why I love you. You always are a woman of God. And all of a sudden, she talked Bubba down from the cliff of going over to do something that was not profitable. That was done by faith. She implored the word of God by faith, not by, you know, I'm not sure what's going to end, what's going to happen. Faith is always based on something God has said. He will never, ever require faith before he gives you something to have faith in. He will give you something, his word, his truth, that you may have faith in it. Does that make sense? Because at every stage of life, let's say, for example, from your young life, you'll need faith in your young life as you're transitioning, following the word of God. When you've become a young man and you got a young family, you have to raise that family by faith. You're going to have to determine what you let into your house, what you're going to allow to come into their spirit, what you're going to allow them to visualize with their eyes and have to process it with their innocent brain. By faith you would do this, not by law, not by rule, but by organic faith. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And you don't talk about, what are we going to do with these kids? I know what to do with your kids, or my kids. And I'm telling you that it won't happen in the school system first. It will happen around your table when they see your heart trusting the Lord by faith. And therefore, the love of God flows in your family. There's a secret sauce once again. Because on the other side, brothers and sisters are hating one another. And people are against one another. People are killing one another. And yet we are in the same world and we're flowing with the love of God. And we're not being pulled over to the dark side. You and Darth Vader. But rather, you stay with the love of God. The reason this is important today, as I close in a few minutes, is that so that you can have confidence of victory through your life, it is done by faith. The just shall live by faith. And through faith, nothing shall be impossible unto you, according to the scripture. Amen? All right. Now, what I'm going to do, I'm going to ask you a quick question. For anybody who has something on their heart that you know it lines up with the word of God, but it's kind of harassing you, the thought of it, or you may have a challenge that is to be overcome by the help of the Lord. So I've got some things I want to overcome, but I'm going to do it by faith now and not by effort. Because God will never tell you to try harder. He doesn't even tell you to try. He tells you to trust him. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. And do not lean on your own understanding. In all of your ways, acknowledge him. How many of your ways? All of your ways, acknowledge him. And he will direct your path. He'll tell you where to go, when to go. Not to quit the job when you want to quit the job. You say, because I hate this job. Hating this job does not mean there's a license for you to quit it. Not when you're being led by God, because God is the one that they have put you on the job that you hate. That you can get all those rough edges off of you. And he said, well, he's really working me over. Yes, he is. Yes, he is. He loved you enough to work you over. Weeping endures for a night, but joy comes in the morning. You better know it. All right. So anybody that's, you know, you got a harassing, I just want to pray for that. Something that's, yeah, I see you there, brother. Anybody else? And I'm, yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sister. All right. There we go. There we go. There it is. All right. Now, I pray. I'm going to tell you what I'm going to pray before I pray it. I'm going to pray that God give you an illuminating breakthrough in your mind, that he elevates his thoughts about the situation, that he tells you how he feels about the situation, that you may have his mind. That is victory, isn't it? Come on now. That is victory. And so therefore, in the name of Jesus, every harassing thought coming against the people that you love, Lord Jesus, reward them by giving them an illuminating portion of your mind concerning the situation and the events and what must be overthrown. Oh God, in Jesus' name, where there is private physical pain, where there are situations that are harassing to the mind, Lord God, thank you for working it out. And by your powerful, loving grace that you minister to their need as they seek your face, in Jesus' name, you say, amen. 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 So the victory for us to live in this life is our faith. You know, Miss Sheila loves me, but I'm sure there's times she got to love me by faith. Just tell you the way it is. Especially when she's air-fried chicken wings and got them nice and hot. And she said, Robin, come on, I got your food fixed for you. I'm coming. Robin, it's hot. I'm coming. But then 10 minutes later, I show up in the kitchen, the chicken wings air-fried the way I like them. I'll cool down now. And so now she's going to either say something she's going to say something or she will have to hold her peace and let the Lord fight her battle. Being married is just the soil to grow in faith. It is. Because you're married to a human. That's why, right there. That does not show up for the hot chicken wings that's been air fried so that she don't have all that oil and grease in it. She did it just for me. She did it. And then I won't show up when it's hot. And then she's got that decision to make. I know you ladies already have this down pat, that I'm not going to say a word. How many of you wouldn't say a word? No hands are up, Sheila. Oh, Miss Lori, you're sweet. She's not going to say nothing. Yeah, now I won't add why you won't say nothing. Because she said that Micah had brought her how far down? All the way down, so there's nothing else lower that she can lose in. So, so she can't be disappointed. This is what she's saying. Yeah, and Miss Lori is an example of great grace because her husband put a toilet on the back, a working toilet on the back patio. And I'm saying, we got hillbillies like some people we know. And then we got, Krista, I'm not saying that about you completely. And then we got another type of hillbilly in Micah, but toilet on the back patio. Amen. It's not there anymore? Okay, I was about to sing Proud to be American, you know. Well, at least I know I'm free. Yeah, but it's not there anymore. Okay. It did serve as a dog. Yeah. The dogs are thirsty. Even the dogs drink the water. Forget about the crumbs. Just what I'm saying is that if she was going to just let that go, she would have to do that by faith. And it's not like I'm not trying to make it difficult, but I got to be a little bit more sensitive. When she says it's ready, your food's ready, that it means something if she has labored, that I need to stop what I'm doing and do that by faith and go to the kitchen, because the just shall live by faith, so that there'll be no conflict, unnecessary conflict in your house over hot chicken. Because we can find anything to get a disagreement about. Am I right? Yes. But if you employ faith, the word of God, the love of God, working on our behalf, and when the Holy Spirit checks you to be quiet, then by faith you... Let's just have a moment of this. You get the point? The just shall live by faith. It's easier to be kind. It's easier to let it go. It's easier to fight the battle another day, because fighting it now won't work. Just when the temperature gets down a little bit, respond then. And then speak the truth in love. Are y'all understanding this? Yeah. And so you don't have to be right. Oh, my God. I don't have to be right. Am I not free? You didn't say that loud enough. I don't have to be right. When Sheila is. Did you hear that? What is it about the man factor, even when she's right? You got some scientific solution. No, right is right. Amen? All right. Let's stand. I'm going to live by what the Bible says. I'm going to live by what the Bible says. Say that with me. I'm going to live by what the Bible says. Yeah. Father, in the name of Jesus, help us that we would please you by living by faith in every aspect of our life, in all of our ways, acknowledging you and your word and what you have to say. That we do what is right as you allow us to see what is right. That the rivers of living water can flow freely through us because the love of God abides in us. And the power of the Spirit of the Lord flows for his glory, bringing revelation to our hearts and to our mind, giving us things ahead of time before they come to pass. Thank you, O God, for coming to us, for revealing yourself to us, for showing us things to come. We thank you for it now in Jesus' name. Anybody here today that needs to be forgiven and cleansed and to just receive that by faith in Jesus Christ, then today is your day. Let's pray together, everybody. Lord Jesus, forgive me, cleanse me, and help me. I dedicate my heart and my life to your service, for you are Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.